One of the things that I'm excited about is, of course, the spiritual nature of the services and what God has to say to us, but also an opportunity to ask his brother questions about him, to find out things we want to know. The things he keeps talking about, how mischievous he was when he was young. yes, inquiring minds want to know. All right, everyone, be blessed, and let's settle our minds as we go into our worship service. Also, the weekend of when the pastor's brother is coming is also the women's retreat at the church in Westlake. And there's a fee. It's Friday and Saturday. So I know some women from this church will be going there this weekend. All right. Thank you for your attention.
13.
Lift up the trumpet and loud let it ring. Jesus is coming again. Cheer up, ye pilgrims, be joyful and sing. Jesus is coming again. Coming again, coming again. Jesus is coming again. Echo in hilltops, proclaim it ye plains. Jesus is coming again. Coming in glory, the Lamb that was slain. Jesus is coming again. Is coming again. Evenings of earth tell the vast wandering throng. Jesus is coming again. Tempests and whirlwinds the anthem proclaim. Jesus is coming again. Coming again. Is coming again. Nations are angry by this, we do know. Jesus is coming again. Knowledge increases, men run to and fro. Jesus is coming again. Jesus is coming again.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath. Today's scripture reading is Deuteronomy 10:13. And to keep the commandments of the Lord and his statutes, which I command you today, for your good. Dear gracious and heavenly Father, we thank you for this blessed Sabbath day. We thank you for the opportunity to gather together to worship you in a group, to combine all of our praises to you. We thank you for your continuous deliverance of us from sin, for your protection that you put around each of us every day. For the loving manner in which you show us your love, we thank you, Lord Jesus. Be with us now as we worship you together. This is our prayer in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
It's story time. You coming up? Hey, we need, you want some company, don't you? Will someone come up? Keep him company? Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
We are all children in the Lord's sight, right? Amen. Look at Ella up there. There was a bowl of candy sitting on the coffee table in the living room of Ella's house. Ella's mother noticed that she was looking at that candy. She said, "Ella, Don't eat any candy until after dinner or you'll spoil your appetite. Oh, the candy looked so good and the temptation was so great. Ella thought, one little piece won't hurt and Mother will never know the difference. Has anything like that ever happened to you? Maybe just once. I thought so. Well, you know what? Everyone in this room, everyone everywhere faces temptation. Do you know that Jesus was tempted too? Yes, he was. The Bible tells us that Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit, returning from the Jordan, and he was led by the Spirit into the desert, where for 40 days he was tempted by our enemy, the devil. 40 days, can you imagine? Non-stop. Jesus hadn't eaten anything. He was hungry, and Satan knew he was hungry. So Satan said to him, if you're really the Son of God, turn these stones into bread. Oh, Jesus could have easily done that, but he didn't. Instead, he answered, it is written, man does not live by bread alone. Well, then the devil had another idea. He took Jesus up to a high place and showed him the worldly kingdoms below. He said, all of this belongs to me. If you'll bow down and worship me, it'll all be yours. Well, you know what happened? Got a 1-2 punch with the Word of God. Jesus answered, it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Well, next, the devil thought, I'm going to take Jesus to Jerusalem and lead him up to the highest point on the temple. He said to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here. God will send his angels to rescue you. Again, Jesus quoted scripture. He said, the Lord says, do not put your Lord, your God, to the test. Satan saw that he wasn't going to get anywhere with Jesus to make him act against his Father, our Father's word. So the enemy gave up and went away. And then the Lord sent angels to take care of Jesus. You know, when you're tempted, remember Jesus' example and how he handled temptation. We can knock out that temptation by remembering the Word of God. Amen. Would you like to say a small prayer? I have one of my little prayer helpers that isn't here today. Can we join hands in prayer? Okay. Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your word. Your word has power to defeat our enemy. And we thank you for ministering to us as we strive to overcome temptations in our life. We also thank you for our Savior, Jesus, and we pray in his name. Amen. Amen. Would you help take up the children's collection? Okay. Children appreciate your donations that will go towards children's ministries here at the church.
editor made a mistake. Again.
You mean he's human?
On our first song for the praise time is not How Great Thou Art. Yeah, it is How Great Thou Art. The bulletin says Amazing Grace. So, are you confused?
Yeah.
Good. We're all on the same page then. Go ahead. Song today. I want us all to stand up and wave across the aisle. Wave. Don't move. Just wave across the aisle and say hello to someone you see. Go ahead. No names? Welcome to the family.
Amen.
We are a family.
Yes, we are.
That someone is here that I haven't seen for a while. I want to greet her back. And Gaydeen, happy Sabbath. I'm glad I embarrassed her. Okay, let's all sing our last and third praise hymn to the Lord. That's the third, which is the second. We brought a sweet aroma by saying hello.
Amen.
Go ahead. And pay attention to the words in this song and take them to your heart. Be not dismayed on every tide, God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love abide, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you through days of toil. God will take care of you. When dangers fierce your path assail, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day or all the way. He will take care of you.
Good Sabbath, church. Well, with everything that's going on in the world today, I mean, it's every single day something's happening. And today I kind of look like I'm ready for space travel, don't I? Gotta admit, with the wings and all. And I think the ultimate space travel is when the Lord comes back. That's going to be better than a rocket ship to the moon or Peter Pan, right? So in the meantime, we do have work to do, because it looks like that, doesn't it, based on everything. So our Lord asks us to bring the tithes and offerings into the warehouse. And the one thing I like about him is he always has something positive to say. And in his word, he says, "I will rebuke the devourer for your sakes, and he shall not destroy the fruits of your ground, neither your vine nor your fruit before the time of the field, says the Lord of hosts." So he always gives us some hope there. And for the younger generation, that's a wonderful passage. We're asked today that we are kind of low on budget, so we ask that you can, when you come into his courts, to give something towards the budget. And of course, the tithes is the 10%, which is separate. Will the deacons and deaconesses rise? Dear Heavenly Father, please bless our tithes and offerings as we present them to you, and help us spread the word throughout the world. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
It's now time for our congregational prayer. And as soon as we finish singing Near to the Heart of God, I'll take people's prayer requests and praise. Okay, anyone else? Pam?
Some people know that I'm diagnosed with bipolar disorder.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Okay. Violet. Yeah, I had written that down because I had seen it on Stella's posting yesterday. Okay, is there anyone else? Gaydeen? Praise the Lord. Yes, yes. We're very glad to hear that. Martha, did you have your hand up? Okay. Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay.
My father had surgery
Thank you, everyone. If everyone who can kneel, if we could kneel to offer up our prayer and praise to the Lord. Dear gracious and heavenly Father, we know how much you love us. We know how much you care about us. And we thank you. We thank you that you're always there for us, that you meet all of our needs, that you listen to us when we speak to you, when we ask your advice. We thank you, Lord, that you're always there for us. We thank you that you continue to provide for us each day. And Lord, we praise you because you are God and you are worthy. And we thank you, Lord, that you have chosen us to be in your family. And what a privilege it is to know that you care about us, that you want things to be good for us. Even though we live in a world that's full of sin and things happen, we still count on your protection. We count on your provisions. But Lord, there are so many people in this world who don't know you, people who don't know your love, and people who are living in fear because they don't know you. I think about the young children in Cleveland who have been killed recently. And I just pray that you would be with their families. And I pray that you would be with the children in Cleveland, because some of them are living in fear because they could be next. We just pray that you would put your loving arms and protection around them. Give them confidence in your love. And even if they don't know you, Lord Jesus, we pray that your family would come near to them and speak to them the words of love that you have to offer. Lord, we think about the situation in Oregon. Here again, someone has committed mass murders, has gunned down people's loved ones, have disturbed people's lives. Lord, only you can fix these minds that are going astray. And we pray that people would allow you to do that, that they would hear your voice, that they would stop listening to Satan's voice, dear Father. And Father, we thank you that Pam has gotten better, but recently now she feels under attack by Satan. Lord, we pray that you would strengthen her and uphold her, that you would lead and guide her so that she will not submit to Satan, but always be open to you. Lord, we pray for those who are sick among us, for Mrs. Yeager, for Aiden, for Pam's father. And Lord, we pray that your healing hand of mercy would be upon them, that they would feel your touch. And Lord, we pray for Nancy's cousin who is leaving this state to go to another state for a job. We pray that the opportunity would be what she is looking for. And we pray that you would be with her and safely be with her as she travels. Lord, we pray that you would be with the pastor as he delivers your word to us. We thank you for our pastor. We thank you for the insights that you have given him. And we thank you for his willingness to share your word with us. Be with us all now as we continue in our worship. This is our prayer in your son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Hear our prayer, O Lord. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Incline thine ear to us and grant us thy peace. Amen. A second scripture reading for today is Revelation 14:6-8. Then I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation, tribe, tongue, and people, saying with a loud voice, "Fear God and give glory to him, for the hour of his judgment has come. And worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and springs of water." And another angel followed, saying, "Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication." May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to do a couple things here because our group today is small and cozy, and that's fine. There's some events going on this week and people aren't here, and then of course we've got the rainy weather and it's chilly outside. So I'm very grateful for those that have come out, but if you don't mind, I'm going to come down here a little closer. And in my doing that for today's presentation, I'm going to ask you to kind of step out a little bit out of your comfort zone. You know, we have our favorite seats. You know, I actually start getting to know people by where they sit. So if I could ask you just to move a little closer toward me, and I'm going to bring this back over here, and I'm going to come down here for today. Is that all right?
Yeah, you like to move it because we know you like it clear.
Oh.
You like to clear.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Normally, I do have this moved out of the way because they know I come down after service, and it keeps me from dodging the mic or tripping over it, one of the two. This is better. I appreciate you moving. We were talking a little earlier. In fact, it was mentioned that there's so much going on today in the news, is there not? And it will certainly tie in with today's presentation and just so much happening in this world. Sometimes, I don't know about you, just kind of
makes you wonder just how much time do we really have left, you know. I have to admit, I have not expected to see the Lord come in my lifetime. But since the Bible says, we know not the day nor the hour when the Son of Man cometh, then obviously that's just something I didn't expect, that it doesn't mean that the Lord won't come next year. There is, at least in our church, and even we have a little pamphlet, Sign of the Times, but the Adventist Church does believe in following the Bible, and so there are still things yet to come that would make you think it would not be tomorrow or next year. But you do need to understand that we are living in the time, clearly, of, is it 2 Timothy or 1 Timothy? I get them, I know where to find it, but I let me just look that up real quick. And when you have a chance sometimes, you should read it, because we are living in this time. So there's three. Yeah. So it would be 2 Timothy chapter 3. And if you go verse 1 to 5, you pretty much have it grasped. We're living in that time today. And for those of you, when you get down to the verse where it says, without natural affection, I want you to use your brains. Truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, I need you to use your brain. We're living in that time. Incontinent means inconsistent when this was written, and we've changed what it means today. It only applies to something you can go buy at the store when you're having some problem with your physical system. But in the Bible, incontinent means inconsistent behavior, unnatural behavior. God knew what this world and the things that we would get ourselves into. Okay, we're living in that time today. Our series, you all pray for me. I'm having my struggles today, but we're going to be all right. We're going to be just fine. Our series is about the Laodicean church. It has been through prayer and faith that this pastor is attempting to draw some comparisons for us concerning the condition of the literal early church at Laodicea. Now, the early church is a term for how the gospel started through church, so that the early church would have been helped and informed in the upper room. Anybody listening to me? No apostle was appointed that some church would be built on them. That's not biblical. Nor in that conversation was that said. Because the conversation, very obviously, for that to be, that would mean that that conversation was in the third person. Anybody study first and second and third person as they came through school in the English language? For that to be what some people have said it is, it would have to be a conversation of our Savior talking to Peter in the third person, which is ridiculous. You do not talk in the third person when the individual standing in front of you. Now, I'm not just giving you something that this pastor believes. I'm not just giving you something that the Adventist Church believes. I'm giving you something that most scholars from major religions believe, and have designated that that is not said. When I tell you something is going to be built on this church, I would be talking about myself. Because it's a first-person, one-to-one conversation. It's not even rocket science to interpret that. You got to really reach to misinterpret that verse. All right. We are in a time where we better keep up, because things are swirling around under an umbrella of disguise that if we are not paying attention, we too can believe anything that is said. So that this series then is about how the early church, even though it started basically at Mass on the day of Pentecost, from 120 people in the upper room where they met after Jesus had gone back to heaven, and they replaced Judas Iscariot. See, you gotta read your Bible. And they replaced Judas Iscariot, funny enough, with another Judas by name. This time, Brother James and Aaron. And they fill out the 12 again. And the Holy Spirit enters the room and blesses them, not just the 12, but 120. And they go out. And then we see the Holy Spirit work, because blessed by the Holy Spirit. Well, how do I know? Well, these people are out there talking to groups of people. Bible listens to the countries they came from, the territories they came from, the languages that they came from, everywhere. And this small group is standing talking to groups of people of different languages. And the Bible says, how can these men speak to us in our own language? Or speak, how can these Galileans talk and we hear them in our own language? That's the Holy Spirit working. That's as close as you're going to get to speaking in tongues. Got to read your Bible. That's as close as it gets. I'm out in New Mexico, Albuquerque, working as a Bible worker. And we're going to evangelize in a Hispanic neighborhood. Between high school and college, I took 4 years of Spanish. When I was done being an A student, because I like foreign languages, I could speak it fluently. But by the time I'm a Bible worker, 9,000 years later, I'm right back to English where I belong. And so I go in, as the evangelist has asked me to do, and I'm knocking on doors to invite them to the big meeting. Because the church, the Adventist church, is in their neighborhood, right on the outside of it, in fact. And I'm knocking on doors. And I say, good afternoon, my name is... Next door. Good afternoon, my name is Clunk. And everybody is, some are polite enough to tell me, no speaky the English. And so I left the driveway and got out in the middle of the street. And I said, now Lord, you got me here. Lord, I really did not ask to come here. I didn't. That evangelist did not tell me I was going to be doing this. But you have me here. I have an assignment to do, which is not just one from the evangelist, but you have me here. I got to invite some people to church. I have to invite some people to church. If you don't help me get something together on my 4 years of Spanish, then I might as well go home. And you know I'm not good at that. I'm always going to try the task put before me. Put that in your hands. You're going to do whatever you're going to do, because I'm getting ready to go to another door. And I walked up to that door, and they answered the door, and I was fluent. And I went from door to door inviting people. Totally fluent. And I left the neighborhood. And I have not spoken that language since. The Holy Ghost can do some things. This church gets started. By the time we get down to the end of Acts 2, the church is so influential, so promising, that the Bible says they had all things common. Out of this church come seven churches. In different territories. And the seventh church formed is like the other seven, all with a purpose. They are literal churches, but God's plan is for us to learn about the history of the church through the seven churches, so that the literal church covers a period of time in history, real history, but the history is about the church, what the church was going through in this period of time. I am dealing strictly with the church at Laodicea, the seventh church, which will be that seventh period of history. Unfortunately, as the church progressed through history, the innocence that they had found in that upper room experience has been lost. The church, quite frankly, would become corrupt. Its members literally seduced by the apostasy that began as early in the church, the seventh church of Laodicea. As time moved on, that apostasy became rampant by the end of the Reformation period from the 15th through 18th century AD. The church at Laodicea covers the time we live in today. But the literal church at Laodicea was a real piece of work. This series has been to compare a church that is in this time that has the truth, that has also become a piece of work and needs some review. The beast, referred to so much in Revelation, is the great seducer. Not so much of the world, and it is, we can see that, but it is a seducer of the church. You got to read Revelation 12. And the dragon was wroth with the woman. The woman in the Bible, in that whole scenario, is the church, not the world. The dragon already has the world under control. He's kicked out of heaven. When you read Revelation 12, God tells the writer John, he says, "Woe unto you, inhabitants of the earth." So he's already got the earth under control. But he's got a particular target with the woman who bore the child, who was Jesus Christ, who started the church. Are you with me? So the dragon is wroth with the woman, the church. The prophetic beast of Revelation 14 has made apostasy its weapon of choice. He's got separate temptations for the world that the church has taken on as well. But his target for the world is just simply have them lost. But his target and purpose for the church is to have them insult God through apostasy and then be lost. It's his weapon of choice in modern times to woo the world and confound it in what 2 Timothy describes as having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. In modern day languages, we talk a good game, but it's all talk. Simply and plainly put, the church is caught up in the world. Let us pray. Now, Lord, bless this message and those of us here to hear it. Bless those who could not make it today. Be with them in a special way in Jesus' name. Amen. The title of today's message is Worshiping the Beast. Worshiping the Beast. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, "If any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand," it's Revelation 14:9. It's very difficult to do a presentation on the book of Revelation justice without including the three angels' messages. These messages found in chapter 14 are part of the foundation of beliefs in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and indeed a standard bearer for our spreading the good news of the gospel. We've mentioned briefly the seven churches, their literalism and their prophetic significance to the historical journey and the experience of the true church. Yes, our primary focus is on the Laodicean part of history. But bear with me as we look at our history in some detail. Briefly, here's how prophecy plays out in the letters to the churches as believed by the and taught by the Adventist Church. The church at Ephesus. The historical period is AD 31 to AD 100. The early church gets compliments from Jesus. But the Savior also charges it with falling away from its first love. That would be the church in Acts 2. The innocence of the upper room and the day of Pentecost is where we started. Drifting from the miraculous moment has been immeasurably detrimental. The church at Smyrna, historical period, AD 100 to AD 313. The church is commended for its perseverance in light of the attack of the false teachings from a group known as the Nicolaitans. The Nicolaitans taught that deeds of the flesh had no bearing on the purity of the soul. That's way back then. Way back then. See, we don't come up with anything new today. Smyrna rejects the Nicolaitan teachings, but Jesus also charges Smyrna with falling away from its first love. The church at Pergamos, AD 313 to 538, Jesus commends the church for holding fast to his name during the long period of severe persecution, because this is a period that's going to take in Emperor Constantine. Things go bad for Christians, because Christians, listen to me carefully, who don't want to be persecuted and hunted down like dogs and then killed, align themselves with pagan rulership and pagan government in a way that they, to protect themselves, evolve into paganism and worship under the guise of following the Lord and claiming God's name, which protects them, and then they become advisors and counselors to the current rule. The current rule at that time would be Rome. Lord, have mercy. During this period, persecution also backs off when Roman Emperor Constantine proclaims tolerance for beliefs separate from his alignment with paganism. But a different and insidious danger begins its rise as Pergamos tolerates where Smyrna rejected the Nicolaitan beliefs. Pergamos tolerates it and the pagan influence. It seems the falling away from the first love continues to go downward. The church at Thyatira, AD 538, 1565, Jesus commends followers of the true church for holding up his teachings and through acts of kindness, developing havens for society, hospitals, schools, orphanages. Names like St. Francis of Assisi, the Waldenses, John Wycliffe stand strong in revealing God's love to the then known world. Adventists do not have a lock on the truth. Can't be when four of the people of the seven that helped start the Adventist church were of different religions at the time. They all came together. One being a Seventh-day Baptist who informed the group of Adventist connectionists at the time who did not believe that the seventh day was important because it couldn't be important. You could worship God any day. And before you start riding too high on your horse, them leading that belief at the time that the seventh day was not that important was Ellen White. So don't ride too high on your horse. Ellen White and James White are originals of the church. They existed when it was called Adventist Connectionists. And before it wasn't even Adventist, they just called themselves the Connectionists. And so the Seventh-day Baptists heard that there was a group gathering, really trying to garner the truths of the Bible. And in the discussions, when they found out that they didn't think the Sabbath was important, that Seventh-day Baptist is the one that convinced them, hello, that is the biggest theme in the Bible. And of course, the Adventists adopted that and agreed. And soon that name would become Seventh-day Adventists, such as Seventh-day Baptists. But the Seventh-day Baptists got it right first. Yeah, I know. Some people out here are staunch. I've been an Adventist for 59,000 years. They're saying this pastor's off his rocker. That's okay. That's okay. We do not have a lock on it. That's why come out of her people didn't say come out of her my Adventist. There's a whole bunch of people that God is calling to come back to the true church. All right. The church is also subjected in the beginning of this period. This is 538 to 1565. Through cruel persecution by the Emperor Justinian, he was one of the worst. He makes his alliance with paganism stronger and legal. Replacing biblical truths with pagan beliefs. Meanwhile, Thyatira also succumbs to Jezebel's style influence in the church through unclean foods, drink, sacrifices to idols. The book of 1 Kings is clear concerning King Ahab and his wife Jezebel. It's clear that Ahab's fall and Israel's decline to heathenism was primarily due to sexual seduction and Jezebel's influence upon the entire kingdom. The church at Sardis, historical period, AD 1565 to 1750. Jesus has little good to say about this period. The church revives briefly after the discovery in the Bible of justification by faith. Anyone remember in their high school studies, college studies, Martin Luther? I should say Luther. The church moves briefly after the discovery in the Bible of justification by faith, a direct contradiction to the teachings of paganism and purgatory. Here, this Catholic priest discovers what the Bible says, rewrites the thesis, if it was called the 95 thesis, nailed it on the front doors of the cathedral, and that was toast for him. Because the teaching and beliefs of purgatory meant money, if nothing else. You could pay. See, you die, and then you go down to purgatory. And you kind of there before God decides whether you go to heaven or not. Well, you can pray, or in a sense, buy your way out of purgatory, back into God's good graces. I don't know how you come up with stuff like that, quite frankly, and then believe in God at the same time. God needs a separate holding place for you, the Almighty God. And then, of course, he needs your pennies to pay for it. All right, I'm not going to go there any further. But the church falls into the trapping of too much focus on doctrine. So while on one end they're fighting one thing, they become very holy and stuck to doctrine. We not only have it right, but the only way you're going to be saved is to be a Seventh-day Adventist. Shouldn't eat meat. But this is back in 1565, Yeah. And which actually, that doctrine and focus on it descended into violent controversy. Holier than thou is not part of the attitude of the church of Acts 2, the church at Philadelphia, historical period AD 1750 to 1844. Missionary outreach shoots across Europe to America. A number of Christians fight for the abolition of slavery. Sunday school emerges as a means, listen to me very closely here, as a means to reach out to the poor at orphanages and to introduce Christianity in colleges. Positive out of this period is the return of personal evangelical religion. And we already have history, already through God worship, coming up with the name of Sunday for the sun god. You do realize down through history, when we start, there's only one day that has a name. God started off and named the days. First day, second day, third day. God gives one day, the seventh day, a name. It's called Sabbath. If you check that out on the internet, everybody from way back in history had a name in their language for Sabbath. Everyone knew when the Sabbath was, is my point. The other days did not have a name. Then came the gods and the god worship. And so we get names for gods which happen to be the name, the days of our week. Sunday after the sun god, Monday after the moon god. Thor was so powerful, he got 2 days, Tuesday and Thursday. Just because life is tough, Wednesday got a name for Woden's Day. Friday, the god of freeze. And Saturday, initially Saturn, the planet, but Diana gets in there. Saturday gets all kinds of stuff. Because Satan needed Saturday to be very confusing. Anything but the Sabbath. By the time you come along to Constantine, who is the original Papa or papal leader of the church. That's a long time after Jesus' conversation with Peter. By the time you get there, he claims the day for himself to be worshiped spiritually. Will somebody read their history? And it finally gets an actual designation as first day worship. You can't come down in 2015 and then tell me that what Paul writes concerning the first day is where you get your designation, or where that day got its designation as the Sabbath. Because in this Bible, it ain't there. Guess I better keep moving. Sunday school emerges as a means to reach out to the poor in orphanages. It is also the period of Reformation, the rise of Protestantism. Be advised that Protestantism originally started based on those believers who were pro-Testament. That meant that they were for the entire Bible. So when they say pro-Testament, they are saying they are for Old and New Testament. And for us to start deleting the Old Testament and sticking with, they were against that. However, they were teaching the Bible, the King James rendition, which had been compiled from the original scrolls, interpreted by 54 scholars that he put together. These were other languages who already had the Bible from the Dead Sea Scrolls. England didn't have it. King James I, with as crazy as he was, that was the one good thing that he did. He wanted England to have it. And so in 1611, that was published in English. But the Bible was actually published before that in other languages. Those believers who protested the rule and influence of the Catholic Church, which received its power from governments in many nations because those nations believed in and supported the Catholic Church's seat at Rome as the official church. I mean, in no way to offend anyone today. I just need you to do your history. This was not given to me in vision. History book, the internet, anything you want to read to find out the real truth, it's there. Such protests by believers of other religions melded the title of pro-Testament, again in favor of Old and New Testaments, to Protestant, which meant in protest of the current religious rule and influence of Rome at the time. And that's how they became Protestants. They actually went into protest, having to be forced to rule, to worship how the ruling government said. And then the church at Laodicea. Historical period AD 1844 to the end of time. The zeal that was born in Reformation and protest is almost immediately lost. As religion's melting pot becomes tolerant of all forms of worship, listen to me carefully. The fall of old Babylon finds itself alive and well in the fall and confusion of modern day religion and worship. Religion itself becomes lazy, complacent, and without desire to reach and teach or return to its first love of Acts 2. It has officially apostatized. In 1844, one church emerges late in the beginning, in its beginnings, and yet early in its existence, realizes through study of the importance of the prophecy found in Revelation 14, the three angels' messages, its simple, straightforward message laid out in the first eight verses. Fear God, give him glory, don't worship the beast. The world must be warned. Worshiping the beast. What is that? How does that happen? The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. That's Revelation 14:10. That's what prophecy promises will happen to those who worship the beast. What beast? And what constitutes worshiping the beast? First, is the beast mentioned in verse 8 of the three angels' messages? It's the beast of apostasy, backed by the original dragon. It's the beast whose tools are deceit and confusion. It's the beast whose confusion is described as making nations drink of the wrath of her fornication. It's the beast disguised in Jezebel-style living and worship, just like Jezebel, who did the same thing to Israel while ruling with Ahab. The king was so weak that he allowed the altars of sacrifice built to God to be destroyed and idols erected in their place. And we might look at Ahab and say, boy, how ridiculous is that? You got that weak? You got that weak that you let your queen seduce you that way? You got that weak from seduction? Before you point a finger, just go easy. I'm not trying to give Ahab any credit. He's totally off the chart. But go easy. She killed a number of the Lord's prophets in an attempt to eliminate worship of the true God. Jezebel seduced King Ahab and in turn most of Israel through wine, drink. I hope I offend no one but today by using the word sex or basic distraction. Jerry got that, or Joe got that picture for me. And so this fall of Babylon, which affects the church and leads to the period of history when we find the church in its most vulnerable condition, yes, Laodicea, is depicted as a seductive woman sitting on the beast with seven heads and 10 horns and holding a cup of wine. The Babylonian influenced Jezebel-styled woman represents the evil and seduction that has affected the church from the rulers of nations for centuries, and today, right into our existing congregations. How in the world do we have 30,000 plus Christian religions today? There was only one early church. You want to tell me we got more than 30,000 churches? Okay. But 30,000 actual different religions calling themselves Christian? This is a depiction of what the early church has become. Because we have aligned ourselves with the way the world worships. And the world worships in a way that was influenced by the Jezebel style thinking. Jezebel, a tool, clearly, of Satan, the dragon, to confuse religion and worship of the true God by mixing it up with all kinds and styles of worship. Now, before you start getting ready to say, yeah, that's why we don't have no drums in our church. Don't go there, please. Just hold back on all the silliness for now. It's not necessary. Fortunately, well, I'm not done here yet. Wait a minute. So, how does it happen? Well, we've fallen away. We've fallen asleep. Apostasy means to turn away from what we originally believed to do something else. And that can be anything. You know, and it's innocent. You know, hey, it doesn't make a difference what day you worship the Lord, just as long as you believe in God. You know? Oh, it doesn't make a difference whether you believe in God or not, just as long as you believe that there's a higher being. And when I get down on my knees and pray, I do not start my prayer saying, oh, higher being, wherever you are, hope you hear me prayer. Please, God Almighty, this is one of your souls, a great sinner on this earth. Please help me. Higher being. That could be anything. And though God has the capacity to come to us in many forms, or whatever form he chooses, as demonstrated at Jesus' baptism, boy, I wish some people would be reading their Bibles. Still, it is the God who created me. But you see, we don't see it that way. No, none of today's religions would consider themselves complacent. We simply see it as we just disagree, we believe differently, and that's all. No big deal. But if we've departed from the Holy Spirit-driven early church, and we have, then who are we worshiping regardless of what we claim? Revelation 14:12 tells us of a group that survives the seduction of distraction plaguing the church today. You know, those Sabbath keepers who follow Jesus. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. Quite frankly, put it is. The law of God that has never changed. The commandments of God is the covenant. That's the old covenant. It is also the new covenant. It is also the everlasting covenant. Regardless of what you hear floating around in our church today, they're all the same covenant. It takes on different titles as it moves through time, because God keeps pressing upon his people to realize this is the same covenant. I'm trying to adjust it to where you are. So the original covenant starts out being called the Ten Commandments. And before it was printed out, God made a covenant with Abraham. Hello? Huh? It's the same covenant. The Ten Commandments is written down. It's the original, even given to Adam and Eve. How do we know that the Ten Commandments did not just start at Sinai? The fourth commandment. He says, remember the Sabbath day. How can you remember something that hasn't been told before? Somebody listening to me today. Remember what I told Adam and Eve. That's where it starts. Yeah, buddy. When you read your Bible, really read your Bible. And so they get so far away, if it comes along Jeremiah, and God says, you know what? Your forefathers tried to treat these as rules, two tablets. Well, I want you to imagine your heart, you know, the way the heart is shaped, divide it in half and consider it two tablets. And he said, I need you to take the covenant and write it on the fleshy parts of your heart. Don't treat the Ten Commandments, God's covenant, as rules, he said. Treat it as a lifestyle. That is the new covenant. That is the new way we treat the commandments. Not as rules, God said, but now in your heart. Live it. Same covenant. Comes down to Paul, and Paul says, oh, the old covenant? Oh, yeah, it's everlasting. It has not changed. So it's only trying to say that the covenant given to Adam and Eve in the garden will always be. The Ten Commandments will still be in heaven as a mark of the original covenant. It's just that for once in our lives, we'll actually be obeying them. Because we all be perfect then and not crazy sinners like we are now. But the covenant hasn't changed. Lord, have mercy. Jesus, help me. All right. So these Sabbath keepers, and then it finishes out when John is asking, well, who are these people? And the angel says, well, these are Sabbath keepers and people that have the faith of Jesus. The faith of Jesus is the lifestyle Jesus lived. Plain and simple. The faith of Jesus, and to have the faith of Jesus or testimony of Jesus, they are the same thing. The faith he had, he testified in his living. Okay. So the question is, are you in that group? If you think you're not worshiping the beast, are you in that group that keeps the commandments and has the lifestyle of Jesus? Let me introduce you to a group trying to raise its head within the Adventist church. From this article on progressive Adventist. In general, they disagree with traditional beliefs held by mainstream Adventists. They are self-described. Areas of disagreement with the church are the Sabbath, investigative judgment, Trinity. One reason they disagree with the Trinity, because someone told them that Trinity is a Catholic word, so they think we shouldn't be using it. Does anybody know what the literal definition of Trinity is? Three. That's the literal definition. Catholics did not invent the word three. simple way to cause, because they do believe in one God and three manifestations. Yes. First place, it's one of the oldest, strongest, best religions on the face of the earth. That's the first thing you need to understand. If you really want to start talking Catholic, that's a strong religion with some strong beliefs. And with all of their problems, they, like Adventists, have tried to at least stick with what they believe. That's why they're having a problem with the new pope. He seems to be watering a little here and there. And some of the folks in the church are saying, wait. This is what we believe. This is what we've been teaching. Is that any different than Adventists? Because a lot of other religions have said, oh, it's watered down. Oh, yeah, let's water it down. Yeah, it was too thick anyway. Let's mix that up. Yeah, come on, everybody. Well, we have to keep welcome on everybody, too. We must welcome everybody. To do what? Learn about what Jesus wants us to do. And when you start learning about what Jesus wants us to do, you're probably going to give up a couple things, just a couple. But you are welcome. All right. So this is the thing that the progressive Adventists are doing now. They are against the Trinity, gift of prophecy, Ellen White writings, remnant, and creation. Ain't holding on to much, are they? Their beliefs are becoming more closely related to ecumenical church environment. It is a watered-down belief. These things just aren't important. Worship God. What day does it make a difference? Worship God. Your lifestyle is not important. Because first place, you're going to be saved anyway, because that's the way Jesus is. He's loving and kind. I don't know. If their Bible left out the part where the Lord burns up the earth, I don't know if that's not in there, or because mine still got it in it. I don't know if they ripped the pages out and didn't sell their Bible without that. Because my Bible talks about a hellfire that I don't want no part of. It's smoke and toast like everything. Nothing survives it. Nothing. And nowhere in there does it say you're going to be saved anyway. But that's just my Bible. It's old. I've had it for a while, maybe. There's been some, you know, updates. You know how we update. This world, I don't know, Lord, how much longer I can take. Fortunately, the Adventist Church rejects their position. By the way, ecumenical simply means that these so-called Adventists are more about beliefs that unify all churches. Basic question, how can you be an Adventist and not believe in the Sabbath? The only one that can unify all churches into one church is come out of her, my people. No church on earth can unify all churches. It's the Bible's call from God that we all go back to the basics. The true church still exists. It's found in God's word. God, come out of her, my people, saying, well, can we come back to that? And God hasn't given that church a title except come out of her, my people church. That's it. He has not turned it over to a religion, because he already knew before man started giving religious titles and creating religion. God already knew how crazy that was going to turn out. And that's what we have today. 30,000, that's just Christian. We ain't even gotten to the others. How has this happened to our church? The article suggests one reason is because our church allowing its prospective ministers, well, here we go, that's it, whenever all else fails, blame us, prospective ministers and church leaders to go to non-theological universities for studies. So the fact that I get a degree from the Methodist Theological in Dayton would eliminate me from, what? I don't totally agree with that assessment, because simply because if one is weak in the faith, That's where your problem is. He or she is weak. Strength, faith in what you believe based on the study of God's word can resist, I repeat, can resist all exposure to teachings and environments not in agreement with the word of God. See, that would curse all Adventists, that you couldn't have your degree from anywhere else but an Adventist college. So on that, I would have to disagree. I can't go with that. When you leave the faith, it is not because of where you got your degree. It's because you were weak in the study of God's word. See, you can be an attorney and be an Adventist. You can be a doctor and be an Adventist. You can be a firefighter and be all those things. Because this is about your faith in God. See, if your faith, first place, is in the Adventist church, you're already in trouble. Some Adventists are going to be saved. And all of us are going to be surprised to see each other there. Yes, we are. Yes, we are. I can't even think about the conversation that goes on when you all are in the little district gathering of all of our three churches, hugging each other and glad, and you see Pastor coming in, and you're going to be like, ain't that crazy pastor we had? Guy used to rant and rave about him. He made it? Yeah, so we all going to be surprised. I know that. So on that, I just have to disagree. We're going to be saved based on what? Our relationship with Jesus. Our relationship with Jesus because we follow the Lord and the lifestyle of Jesus and accept the things that Jesus taught. And that's actually who Jesus is coming back for. If you happen to be a Methodist and that's where it is, you'll probably be saved. If you're a Catholic, you will probably be saved. If you're an Adventist, you will probably be saved. Come out of her, my people, is the call. All right. So, God's word certainly isn't weak. It's the lack of study and application and prayer that causes us weakness. There's no middle ground. That's why the letter to Laodicea is so harsh. You can't remain lukewarm. You can't stand on the fence. You must choose. You must become hot or cold. Making a decision to follow the Lord can and will give you strength, can and will make you strong. With that definitive choice, hot or cold, whichever it is, then God can work with us. My mom used to tell me, make a decision. She said, you can't be on the fence. I'd tell mom, well, I don't want to make the wrong decision. She said, that's not good. That's how you learn. Make a decision, right or wrong. If you're right, the Lord carries you along. If you're wrong, the Lord's going to allow some things to happen to show you you're wrong. It's a part of life. He works with hot or cold, but not both. He doesn't work in the middle. God is an either or God. Was there a middle choice there? He gave you the middle choice. And what did he say he'd do? If you're lukewarm, I'll spit you out of my mouth. God's either or. No middle ground. Make the decision. I don't care what it is. Make the wrong decision. Only thing with making the wrong decision is not learning from your mistakes. If you're that stupid, and there's a period of my life that would attest to that, if you're that stupid, then God's got some other consequences that comes along with the stupidity of continuing to make the wrong choice. And I'm a witness. Please get it right finally. And don't wait till my age to do so. Good night. Well, if you're not sure what to do, then how can you be sure that you're not worshiping the beast? Worshiping the beast is the result of distraction, the result of complacency. This is not about the format of our church worship. This is not about having or not having a bulletin. This is not about the order of service. This is not about our upbeat music or lack of upbeat music. Few or any of those things have little or nothing to do with worshiping the beast. And I, as your pastor, have little or no time to consider any of those things, to be upset about it or not. If the church likes the style of music that we have, let's keep stroking. You want to change it to something more upbeat than what we have? Fine. I might intervene when I find that the music no longer seems to be celebrating the Lord as it is celebrating us in our performance. So it's not about upbeat music. To be happy and enjoying the Lord. But it's easy to tell when we're performing. And we really have forgotten about God. We just now having a good jam. That will not work with this pastor. But I was raised in a gospel singing church. My family still does today. When I go home to visit, they are praising the Lord. They're at it. They are getting on it, praising the Lord. And there is shouting, and there is clapping, and there is crying, and there are broken hearts and happy hearts, all under the guise of lifting praise to the Lord, because it's about, the music is about the experience we've all gone through. I come from a large and crazy family. We've done a lot of crazy things, and when we see each other, and we see the Lord still has us alive and still has us believing in Him, and we come together, oh, we're having a good time. But we know what to do to the performers. You get us one chance. You get to perform one time. You won't be back. Because this is not about you showing off with the talent that you got from God. This is about taking that talent and giving it back to God. There's a big difference. And I don't care if the talent is supported by drums or guitars. I don't care about that. Because I have a Bible where the Lord tells them, get out the cymbal, the drums, get out the horns. God is telling them. And why? He says, we're getting ready to worship. That's what we're getting ready to do. We're getting ready to have a hoedown, the Lord says. Get the instruments out. So don't come to me with, it's wrong to have instruments in church. You have a deaf ear. But we're not going to be foolish. So you're out there saying, well, then where is the pastor really in on music? Huh. I just told you. I am concerned about whatever distraction. See, distraction is key for me. May be affecting our complacency. Because while we're doing nothing or try to remain on the fence, I guarantee you we worship the beast in one form or another. And just as that Jezebel-style living seduced Israel, Revelation 14 tells us we too will drink of the wrath of God and suffer the torment of hell in the end of time. Just an added note, please do not feel compelled to change the music here. Not for me. I come to worship the Lord, and every time I'm here, I do just that. God is using the talents that we have. When other or different kind of talent comes, let's embrace that too. Remember, we can sing hymns all day long, and it does not mean we have worshiped the Lord. Quite frankly, we don't know how to worship the Lord. A sinner can't know how to present the service that is actually holy unto God. We don't know how. A sinner can't know that. So in faith, you give it your best shot. For some, that might be this style, and for some, that style. But God will accept it based on, is it worship? Some of us are going to leave here and go to another church and going to say, boy, that was out of hand. Can't do that. And others are going to come here and say, boy, they sure are low-key and boring. You're both wrong. Because none of us knows what's actually acceptable to God. But if we do it in faith, it will be. Kind of get self out of the way and worship the Lord. It will be accepted. Well, guess we'll pray. I just want us to realize that I believe that, well, I'll say it this way. I don't believe we are the true church of the Latter-day Saints. I do, though, believe that we are the true church based on what we teach. Did I just say the Adventist is a true church? No, I didn't. I said based on what we teach. As long as the Adventist church sticks with the Bible, we're going to be safe. We can respond easily to come out of her, my people. If we just stick with that, my big concern is that we are just falling away. Falling away. We want to catch up with the rest of the world. Their congregations are huge. On our best day here, we don't fill the church. And there are churches around right now with 2,000 members, where you could always go worship in the stadium of Joel Osteen, has 50,000 seats. As a pastor, do you get jealous or envious sometimes to be able to want to think that what you're preaching has impacted people to that point? It goes through your mind. But if it means I have to sacrifice the truth to fill the church, no, thank you. I'll preach the truth before 50 or 50,000. You can accept or leave out those doors. If I've preached the truth, I won't run after you. You're under the hands of the Holy Spirit to be convicted. I've already done my job. Let's bow our heads. You're good, Lord. We resemble the Laodicean church as it has fallen off, but thanks to you, we have not been lost. Our church, too, will go through struggles. But our faith in the Bible, and as long as we cling to it, I know that your plans is to bring this people into your kingdom. Help us to be serious about that enough to tell somebody. Not about Adventism, but about your truth. And then you will guide them into your truth. Thank you for all your blessings. Bless us in a special way in Jesus' name. Amen.
Respond. our pastor's message today by standing and singing, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning in Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. We're leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. We're leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on the everlasting.
Worship other places this week. Lord, what we want when the sun sets and the dust settles and at the end of the day and the end of time, we just want to be saved. We want to all see each other again, spending joyous, yes, joyous times for the rest of our life. No tears, no sorrow, no death. Lord God Almighty, save us all. Amen. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.